the offer is there, and what they're not, what they can do with helping is that they're very much to do with the But the fire service very clearly has the capacity to be doing more than just the fires.
Which many of us on this side of the contender. and looking at how will the council can actually be an example employer and lead the way in this really. So maybe to do some work on how we can do that and look at using Wirreburra Council and the way it treats its employees and the terms and conditions that we have for its employees regarding the living wage, which as you rightly say there, has a huge impact on health and well-being of not only the person receiving that wage but the family and the wider community. And how we can case study that to employers in the local area and make a business case really, because you talk about huge savings there, not only for the employer, but as for the environment as a whole, you know, for the human race as a whole, if you like, you know. So I think some of the things that Wirreburra Council are doing are impacting on that really well. But maybe we could scrutinise the areas where we can improve that, linked in to the report that you just said.
I think you know, there was a conference last Friday, I think, on the living wage, and the council is a living wage. What I would also say is that the public sector board puts together a group that is looking right across the major agencies about the living wage and what would be the impact and what would be the issues and so on. So I've tried to implement that on the role. So it will be
As a member of the planning committee, I was particularly interested in what you were saying about planning and spatial policy, because I think you are right in what you said, in that members, particularly of that committee, can often feel impeded in trying to make decisions for the benefit of public health when officers suggest that it would be unlawful for us to do so or would be against a particular policy. So have you got any direct or practical involvement with planning officers in relation to improving their thinking and knowledge behind these areas? And you know, you mentioned that Public Health England in relation to the powers that local authorities have now on limiting the amount of takeaways in particular. Those practical examples, how are you making sure that our planning department are aware of those?
Thanks for the presentation, Fiona. I think everything you've highlighted is definitely the best way for a better, healthier life. I just wanted to raise about the cycling. I mean, I agree with cycling is great, but I speak to a member of the Rural Cycling Campaign and the Cyclist Touring Club. But quite honestly, I would not recommend too much cycling because it really is hazardous. As someone that's, I've now cycled to work for about 30 years, and I do find now that motorists don't seem to have a clue about cyclists. But I don't think that's because they're deliberately dangerous, but I think it's just because they probably have never cycled. You know, people of my age, we were obviously pedestrians, cyclists, we had motorcycles, scooters, onto four wheels. So we have a different perception for cyclists, and you know, I certainly think cyclists of my birth, but I noticed a number of people that passed within inches of me. I mean, just to give you an idea, I was cycling along Asheville Road, which is between Bonks and Birmingham, four cars wide, and a quiet Sunday afternoon, and a car mirror hit my handlebars. And that's the sort of thing we have these days, because a lot of motorists just don't have a clue on giving cyclists sufficient room or anticipating where a cyclist has to move out to overtake a vehicle. And just a final thing, just to say that it seems to us, or it seems to me, there's a lot of cycle paths on the roads where really there's not much hazard. But I mean, if you cycle on Borough Road in Birmingham, there's no cycle path there. And that's the places we need more protection for cyclists. That's what I should be advocating. But I agree with your, you know, it is a healthy way if, as long as motorists are more considerate.
I think you need to get back on the cycle for water.
It's a very, very in-depth report, and we couldn't discuss all aspects of it here tonight. There's so many areas that need to be discussed. And just before, we have spoken today for a number of occasions about how planning can interact with public health saturation for off licences and individuals. So I know he's very, very supportive. But this is a couple of things that I've sort of looked at, and I'm not going to go into all of them because we can't. Enforcement. For the road safety in the 20 miles, you know, we've got millions of 20 miles in our zones, and we cannot afford to have it enforced properly. So all comes back to money and to what happened. The warm homes projects have all got their own. Some people are entitled to them, some of them aren't. So there's all of that. Social isolation, once again, we can't rely on volunteers and just befrienders. We've got to have a proper policy on social isolation that's backed up and supported through social workers and through others. So there's all the social isolation. The fire services do a marvellous job. I haven't declared an interest because we didn't have to do all the local ones, but they refer into AGK and to other agencies because of all the home visits they do. So they're working really well with the public. And I mean, there's so much to do with this. It's a very, very useful policy, but it's going to need an awful lot of funding and an awful lot of support from an awful lot of departments to get it up and working. But at least it's a start.
There are a couple of things I'd like to say. I mean, there's always a lot of talk about saturation point being reached with, and I keep on saying this, with off licences. But actually, the same is the case with fast food licences, particularly in Rockbury. In one area, we've got eight, I keep saying this, but in one very, very small areas, we've got eight fast food licences. And we've got one that advertises itself as the healthy one, which is great, isn't it? The other point I'd like to make is that constituency committees with public health spend are useful and maybe the right way to go to get rid of it. Okay, we'll get to that one. Okay. And you said at the outset that there's a few things in this that we'd like to look at for future work. And as Bernie said, the whole thing is really, really thorough. Far too much there for us to take a look. But one of the things I would like to know is, have we got any sort of idea of how we'll is performing already on these things? And not for today, I don't expect you to answer that, but is that at some point when we're looking at work programmes for next year, can we look at how Wirral is performing against all these to see how much work there is to do here?
Thank you.
think one of the things I was thinking about is the EPS data analysis. As you know, every year I do an annual report, a health annual report, which is in effect an audit around various aspects of health. And I was planning to focus this year's health annual report on an assessment of just where we are with some of these things. I don't know if members would feel that would be a useful idea. There may be some things that you'd like to know about sooner. But I would, it is an independent produced report, but it's a council's duty to produce it, so I'd rather do it with, on something that the members felt would be of value. So it's just a suggestion that we can do it in that way, or we could do it more deep more generally. As you wrote, I can give you a chapter of that, so I'm not to look at it, so it would be a way of putting together some of that evidence.
I think that would be very helpful for my report. I think what was also useful is to know what is the risk factor. There's a lot of plans and shoulds and maybe should go over something. I think it would be useful to know what we can do when we're all planning and licensing for the risk factor. It's useful for us to actually encourage and support. That's what I think.
Yeah, I'm certainly sure. We'd love to be able to apply some of those principles on occasion. So we'll look forward to that. Good. Thank you very much, Fiona. One of the aspects that you spoke about was the beginning of life, and Julia, you've got the report for us, our next report, is about a particular project